I'm going to call on Sergeant Savage now to tell a story of that surrounded platoon. Had 29 men going into that battle under strength, courtesy of Lyndon B. Johnson, and a few malaria cases, etc. Platoon leader was quickly killed. Platoon sergeant was quickly killed. Numerous other men, 8 in all. Sergeant Savage, Buck Sergeant, 85, 3 stripes, took command of that platoon. We rescued them 25 hours later. 8 dead is all they had. No more killed. 13 wounded. And the rest came out alive, unscathed. They had ammunition still left to fight with. Now that's discipline. Sergeant Savage, come up here and tell us what.
You step in front of a group of people like this to talk to, and you really feel insignificant as an individual. There's a great group of people here. I know most of you. Some I know only by face, others I know personally. And it's a real honor for me to be up here and have an opportunity to speak to such a group of brave individual soldiers. Captain Herring, Colonel Herring, we've been calling him Captain Herring since yesterday because we hadn't came out of 65 for the 27 years since I seen him. So it's been Sergeant Savage and Captain Herring for the last 2 days, but we know he's a retired colonel. Asked me, did I have my speech written? I said no, because I don't really know what I'm going to say, so I don't know what to write down. So I'm up here without anything written down, but I got a pretty good idea of what it is I need to talk about. But I know if I run into problems, that I've always got help set back there in the back corner. They came through once before, I know the knife I get in trouble other than that. I guess the most important thing about that battle is the men that fought in it, the men that survived it, and the men who died there. There were a few people appointed heroes out of that battle, primarily because they were put in a position for other people to see what was going on and indicate that they were heroes. But that everybody was a hero in that battle. So I don't intend to stand up here and tell any war stories, because this gathering itself is a war story. But I would like to go back over what the type of people that I knew that was in that engagement, type of training, and basically what happened during that engagement from my perspective, and try to some way convey the feelings of myself and other people when we were out there waiting on Captain Herring and Colonel Halbor at the time to come get us. Most of you already know how much training we went through before we went over there. There's a few reintroductions, so I'll go back and do a little bit on that. I joined the battalion and February of 65, so I was not with the unit very long. Fortunately, that unit had been training together over a year and a half at that time, about a year together, I believe. So the squad that I inherited was already trained. It was just a matter of breaking me into my particular personality and cleaning up a few loose ends from my perspective. Going into the battle, there were two or three things that we had to our advantage. One was the training. Everybody was well trained. And if you think about it, back in those days, the training that the individual soldier got and the training that the NCOs got was the responsibility solely of the commanders. Now we have specific courses that do a lot of training that took place in the unit back in those days. We didn't have the luxury of the academy system, NCUS systems, things that the Army does have. So the training of those individuals reflects the leadership and the commanders in that unit. So we went in there well trained, well led, and well armed. The other thing is the individual soldier himself. And some of the finest soldiers I've ever served with, before or had to that. I've never had the feeling of closeness that I had with those individual soldiers. We still have that today when you run into someone that was in your unit at that time. It's just a special feeling for that person. You never forget who those individuals are. So you had the leadership, the training, the individual soldiers. Morale was real high in those units. They were very proud of who they were. If they belonged to the first squad, then the first squad was the damn best squad in the battalion. Of course, it went on up the line. The best platoon, the best company, the best battalion. Depending on who you belonged to, what you had was the best. And when they trained and when they fought that away. The night before we went in there, I believe we were, if I remember right, we were securing brigade headquarters. And we had done some patrolling and stuff the night before. So everybody going in there was not fresh. Some folks had not slept very much the night before. I can remember going into the LZ, very little fire, if any at all. I didn't hear any when I came in. And we landed on the ground, broke up the sea rations, and then that's the last thing I remember is four sea rations. And I think they're still sitting there by that tree. But we went to the flank of the first platoon, I believe it was, and it so happened that there was an NVA coming down from the right side, I think it was a point man or whatever type unit that was, and Lieutenant Herrick, using bad judgment at the time, I thought it was bad judgment, turned and chased those people. That's how we ended up getting trapped, if you wonder what happened. We chased him out 200 or 300 meters, and that time we run head on, and whatever size unit that was, it wasn't much bigger than a platoon, I can tell you that. So we did a little maneuvering around there and did the best we could to put as many of them down as we could. And I looked off the right flank and realized that we were wholly outnumbered. That's how we got cut off. They outflanked us and surrounded us on that hill. Of course, we fought there all that afternoon. The artillery, the courage, the determination of the men on that hill is the reason I'm standing up here today. From the platoon's perspective, they fought very bravely, very hard. They fired the weapons accurately. One of the biggest problems that the enemy soldier had was firing over our heads. I think we picked that up right away because most of the guys were firing with the weapons on the ground, so the rounds were not going over their heads. We had a lot of bravery going on up there. A lot of people sacrificed their lives for the benefit of the whole. And particularly the machine gun crews. I'm not going to stop talking. In worse situations. Right on. But anyway, the machine gun crew is one of the reasons the rest of that platoon survived on the hill. And I wanted to bring that out clear here. And every time I think about it, I get close. Second time. That didn't end the battle, of course. We stayed up there for 25, 26 hours. They tried to overrun several times, and they never accomplished that mission. There's three or four reasons for it. One, I've already said, the men on the ground. The other is the artillery and the aircraft, the attack aircraft. Give a couple more minutes here. But I think it's a big part of that battle everybody overlooks when they're looking at the platoon. First of all, they look at the platoon, the actions of the platoon, and the artillery, the aircraft that was dealing and supporting the platoon on the hill. Of course, the men up there fought very bravely. We used the supporting firepower as well as we could under circumstances. But there's one other thing that I think everybody has overlooked. I haven't overlooked it. And that's the efforts by Colonel Moore at the time to get us out. Because every time they made an attack to get us, that kept them off us. So every time attack was made to try to relieve us on that hill, it actually pulled the enemy's attention away from us, and of course killed a lot of them too. And that definitely gets your attention away from you to kill. But I think he attacked, his company attacked two or three times that afternoon, three times I remember right. I know each time that they attacked, they'd always tell me when they were pulling back and couldn't make it. And I know A Company, C Company, B Company knows how I feel. A and C Company commanders and men, we know there was a sacrifice there. You just don't attack and turn back without losing people. I knew that. So did everybody else. You know, and I'd like to thank everybody who was involved in that from the platoon standpoint. They're not here. And that's the main reason I came here to talk. And I was hoping I could control my emotions a little better. About that battle there, and I've read quite a few books on it. Just about everyone, where you talk about a firefight in Vietnam, that platoon showed up. But the men in that platoon were no different than any other platoon, at any rate, or in just about any of you, as far as that's concerned. They just had to be put in a situation where they had to do what they did. They were trained to do it. They were well led, and they knew they could depend on the commanders to go back to X-ray. I stayed on that phone, telephone, radio, the whole time I was up there, around 24 hours, the thing was stuck in my ear. I talked to several people back there, a few of the voices I recognized, a few I didn't. Sergeant Gilbert's. Sometime around 3 o'clock in the morning, he woke up and came on the phone. On the radio was talking to me. I think he was trying to keep me awake up there, but he didn't have a problem staying awake. And it was an encouragement, and the guys in the platoon told me afterward they could hear me talking on the phone to the people back on X-ray. They could hear me talking as far as just an artillery concern. They knew just about everything that was happening on X-ray, every move they made. Trying to get us, everybody knew that. And I can remember when Captain Harris at the time called about 5:36 o'clock in the afternoon after the last attack. And he said, my call sign was 4-2. He said, 4-2, this is 6. I said, this is 4-2. He said, we ain't gonna make it tonight. Do you think you can hold out? I said, we've already won this battle anyway. And Jerry Zalen, good buddy of mine, another sergeant squad leader, was laying beside me. I looked at him. He said, it's okay. It's okay. And luckily, we survived the night, primarily because of training the people, because of company commanders like Captain Harry, because of battalion commanders like Maryland Lieutenant General retired, and because of the NCOs and the men, the training, the support, and the faith, and by the luck of God, we survived that. And I probably could have done a better job if I prepared something, but I think that I've said what most people would want me to say from that platoon. And I do want to again tell A Company, B Company, C Company, and the people, we knew you were there all the time. We were kept informed. We had faith in you. We had faith in ourselves. And I proceed this thing with saying that I thought that Lieutenant Herrick had made a terrible blunder as far as tactical discerning he did. He shouldn't have made that move. But I personally think that we owe his our lives, possibly the whole battalion's lives, to that mistake made by that little second lieutenant. But I personally think that what we hit coming down the bottom would have been in behind us if we had not done that. That is my personal opinion. The overall picture, when looking at it from General Moore put it together, I still believe that that platoon being trapped actually saved the battalion, possibly at least saved a lot more lives would have saved the battalion. And I appreciate y'all letting me speak to you. And I do feel awful humble, but I look out across here and I see some great people, some brave men. Thank you very much.
I have a particular attachment to myself because he was an officer in my company. But I'm going to let Joe Galloway introduce him nonetheless. So Joe, if you'd come up and do that, please.
Our next speaker is Second Lieutenant Rick Rescorla, Cyril R. Rick Rescorla. He said that that was all I was allowed to say about him. But he's wrong. Rick commanded a platoon in Bravo Company, 2nd of the 7th. They were bears on the line in X-ray. They jumped into Albany in a dark helicopter assault on a very hot LZ, led by Captain Myron DeDurick, one of the great company commanders in any man's army, no longer with us. Rick Rescorla is a dream of a platoon leader as he waited in his hold for the enemy to come. He sang to his men songs to build strength, to strengthen them for what was coming. And I'm not going to say a lot more than that. Come on up, Rick, and tell your story.
Hardcore! Hardcore!
Hardcore!
Hardcore!
Great to see all of you. It's like preaching to the choir and telling a war story to this group. And I don't have a doctorate in religion, but I'm not going to tell a war story. I want to tell you a personal story of an immigrant who came to this country looking for a home and found one and started out that idea of staying here by serving with the 7th Cavalry and serving with a fine first team, the 1st Division. At Ia Drang, I was involved with two battalions, two very different battalions, with two very different commanders, with very different missions, with very different outcomes. But they had something in common. They had aspects of personal survival. They had men who would stand up and die for what they believed in, their own troops. They had patriots, and they had jailbait. They're fighting on the line together. X-ray. I'm going to call this one dedicated to the 1st and the 7th and call it in the caption, "Oh, the wild charge they made." You take off and you get into a Huey. flown by strange, crazy individuals, robots. Robots. Yeah. The name of Too Tall or Pop, Chiefy. Strange guys who would never speak to anybody below the rank of captain. Get on that strange steel beast and go into the X-ray, already a developing battle, and see the smoke rise and hear the sounds and the rotors quicken and get put down there and put down hard. Bounce straight in like that. Jump out and watch another helicopter smoking, never get off the ground again. Go into the action with your men and see over here, there's a man. Sergeant Major Plumley. In charge of this strange little group with another man on the radio there calling the shots. You get told by your company commander, Myron Dederick, they call him the Mad Cossack, but actually he had a heart of gold and will give you enough rope to hang himself. Go ahead, fix bayonets. You go back to the British background because you were a British sergeant and you give it this way. Platoon will fix bayonets. Fix bayonets. Well, you know, in training, that's where everybody growls. Well, what do they do now? They don't growl. They look at you and say, are you shitting me? You go forward into the ditch. And as you enter the ditch, things change slightly for you because the gung-ho aspect you had of this thing, and now change, you're looking at a man, American, lying dead facing you, a ditch sometimes called a creek. And around you, there are some wounded. And then you see an individual who says, I'm Tony Dedal. Put your men along this line. We're going to hold. The light is changing. It's changing from into that twilight area. And you shove your men on the front end of the ditch, the leading end of the ditch. They say, the enemy is that way. But we've also got a platoon out there. The ditch is not a great place to be, really. You realize that because ditches don't select fields of fire as if they were critical terrain features or anything. They follow the topical movement of the land, which is low. So you don't have a good field of fire, but you wait that night and you listen to a radio of probably a dead man out there fairly close, chattering away. And you got a sobering thought. The ditch stretches on beyond, along this way, and you have to go down it to alert your platoon using a strange little box, an intrusion detector they gave us with, remember that little thing with cotton wire and everything else, which was supposed to go off when somebody came in. And you put that down, and that's all you have on that flank. So it's a rotten night, and made worse the next day when you hear the gut throb of an attack going off to the southeast. A terrible attack, and you know that somebody's getting the hell knocked out. And by this time, the whole game has changed, and it's a more sobering experience for everybody there, and your men are looking about it. And there are no more gung-ho aspects of it. Another snapshot. Later on, you're moving towards in that area. They're sending you down there. And somebody drops napalm from above, and it's aiming for you. You turn and run with the rest of your platoon. The pucker factor is right there this time. And you feel the warmth and the heat hit you in the back. And you go down. Your medic gets up and runs towards the burning men. And he is immediately shot through the temple and he falls. And you move to him. And you hold him in your arms. And he takes a while to go. And you say to him, the only thing you can say to him, because you know he's gone. Going, his chest is heaving. You say to him, you're not alone, son. You're not alone. You're not alone. That's all he can say. And Tom Burlisle dies right there. Draftee, didn't like the army. Said, what have I lost in Vietnam? He didn't want to be in Vietnam. but he answered the call of his country and his commander-in-chief, and he went. And at the same time I'm mentioning men dying, I'll talk about the platoon. I hope I get the pronunciation right. But Jack, also known as Lance Vahid, we end up in that platoon and we see those men there who are dead. As part of that, there are two individuals there that I'm drawn to. One has a name tag, Gomez. And what has clearly happened, these men are locked together. One man has been wounded, the other man was being taken out. And that was what that noise was you heard in the morning. And they're locked together there, two individuals. Locked together, dying as brothers in that platoon, among the other brave men who died in that platoon. And they bought us the time. And I'd say this about all the men we encountered who died, especially the draftees. America owes a debt to them, and I hope the president-elect surely will remember what he owes to draftees, the men who answered their country's call. They went out there and they did the job, realizing a commander-in-chief represents his country. We owe a lot of things to those fellows. Jumping forward a little bit, you have a lesson in democracy, real quick, from a man called Hal Moore. Because you're there looking and you're interested in the bodies of the North Vietnamese that these brave men have killed and bought the time with. You're picking up souvenirs, if you will. And you hear a voice say, who's in charge here? You go over to this man, he doesn't have too much fancy badges on, but you realize he's the battalion commander. And you think you're going to get your butt chewed out, because you are wrong, you are looking at something entirely different. And he says to you, I need your help. These are my boys, and I want your men to help me send them home to their loved ones. And what do you say to that? You say, yes, sir. And you move, and you do it, and you carry them to the helicopters. You got plenty of time to prepare because of these individuals who bought time for you. And you go, and you do your preparation, your homework. You dig in. You have all those things that the American Building 4 down to Fort Benning tells you. You dig deep, the parapets and everything else, and you're ready. You have experienced NCOs, and God bless them. Thompson, Eschbach, a strange-looking guy, you know, wouldn't get in today because the uniform wouldn't fit too well. A skinny sort of a character who carries a canteen with a mixture of vodka in it and orange juice. And he says, I tell you what we'll do, we'll booby trap. Jerry rig it. We don't have you look around for the claymores and somebody's screwed up. But you have those hand grenades and American initiative. You go down there with a commo wire and you butterfly it out and you do your job. And that night, starting 11 o'clock, shall we say, the probes start, the attacks start come afterwards. It's a long night. You do what your best you can to reassure your men, to pump them up, to shout to each other, and fire by volley. Not only when they're attacking, but fire by volley when they aren't, they're not moving at all. And that, you're trying to put yourself in the position of the North Vietnamese out there and make them pay. This is payback time. And when you fire that demoralizing fire, you know you're getting home. You can hear them screaming out there, you can hear the whistles out there. And your men are shouting, your men are firing, and they're doing their job. Through the night, and then the final assault, by this time you've thinned them out. But you're also fighting against brave men, North Vietnamese. Why they do it, why they did it, I don't know. But they were terrifically brave men. Some would argue there's somebody back there with a pistol saying you better move up. But they moved up. One went so far as to put his head down on the parapet as he was shot right out on the parapet of our platoon. Dolan comes up. A couple of movements. Man blows himself up. Another one's shot. Then the movement comes to move out. And I think the picture may be a part of that movement. You go out there with some sort of a confidence, but they're still out there, they're firing at you. Grenades again. Again, some bitter stuff. Not pleasant stuff, but your platoon are there and they're looking after you. The smell. Terrible smell of the Vietnamese. A different sort of smell gets to you. And your men, as you're moving out from X-ray, throwing up. The sore sight of their own wounded. The terrible sight of their own wounded. The next one I will call very quickly to stand and be still. The Birkenhead drill is a damn tough bullet to chew, and this is my battalion, the 2nd of the 7th. You get on it, you're back there resting, and there's some guys throwing rumors around that you are going back to sell bonds because you've been such great soldiers. No time to go home. And some message comes through, and the Derek says again, fire up, your battalion's in the shit. Let's go. A proud moment as you lead them down because you know it's got to be a bad setting condition. The light again is changing as we go in. But it's a proud moment walking down past the rear echelons and getting on those helicopters. As an immigrant, you know, they made you an officer, you know, in their army. Giving you this responsibility. It's a tremendous, tremendous feeling. You go in again with madmen flying, and they're saying things like, hell no, we can. Yes, we can. No, we can. Shit, let's do it. As we're flying in, we see the bodies of North Vietnamese lying up, a lot of North Vietnamese. And at that time, I said to my radio operator, Fantino, look at this, North Vietnamese. He said, he was looking at the other side of the plane. He says, a lot of Americans do. We go in, they put us on an LZ. However, they don't put us down with a bomb. They hover high above and say, get out. I tell them, too high. Ankle twisting distance. The machine gunner, now they tell the machine gunner, get him out. And he says, get the out. So we fall 10 or so feet.
or more.
They push in the sea rations on top of us.
That's right.
Across here, two or three Vietnamese stand up and run a flat run without any weapons, and we throw down on them. At that time, a machine gunner, our own machine gunner, of course, one of those door gunners, opens up on us. And you can see the tracers walking in, and it's a terrible moment when you're trying to low crawl in reverse. We're lost at that moment. We don't know where we are. And there's crackling going off, you know, the firing, one or two shots over here. Not a great battle going on, but individual shots. And we hear the cry of, over here, over here. We race in there with the sea rations and everything, and contact our own battalion. And the first thing we see is the Sergeant Major Scott. And he is lying, bleeding from the chest, lying against a tree. He says, hurt bad, sir, whole battalion. You go over and there's a fire plug of a man, Frank Henry, who's on that radio chattering away. Get it done, trying to get it done. And you meet other individuals there who are forming the hasty perimeter that we will assume that night. And during that night, a man comes in, and he's my thought about what Americans are about. A man called James Mullardy staggers in during the evening. He's shot through the teeth, right through the back, just missing his spine. And he staggers and he falls against the tree and says, carry on. You know, that's some brass ones there. No doubt about it. And it does sustain you. you know, that sort of personal survival, that aspect you have, these individuals down there. Individuals coming in. We know there are men out there, the worst night I've ever spent in my life. And I know it's true of the commanders there. These men were hurting. No idea, in this darkness, who's where. More people outside your perimeter, either dead or wounded, than inside the perimeter. Terrible moments. The next, during the dawn, there's a mad minute, because we're concerned about our survival too. Because it's hindsight to say, as some people have, some lower ranking staff officers has mentioned, that, hey, you should have done this, you should have done that. But we didn't know. We were hit, we had wounded. Stepping out into that arena out there with Jack Smith and everybody else is a deadly game. Your own people could shoot you. So it was a terrible moment. Spoke to a platoon leader that night who said, you know, I don't know where they are, crying. Had to stay in that perimeter, he was ordered to do so. Battalion commander, Colonel McDay, doing his best. We go out in the morning, and inside me, I'm saying to myself, I thought I was going to be, you know, Lassie saved the day. But what has happened here is, these individuals on the ground fought their way and held their ground. And the miracle to me is, not what some people say, how many guys did you guys lose in a second or so? How many guys survived in a second or so? Hit with what they were, the machine guns and everything else, from critical terrain features, which in the North Vietnamese term were nothing but termite hills. But these guys knew how to use them. They knew what they were doing, and they're brave men. Take nothing away from them. Going down among the wounded, see the guys come forth to you. Tears in their eyes, you know, God. As if you rescued them, and you hadn't, because they rescued themselves. They spent the damn night. They fought the hours. They said they weren't going to die. And you know all the stories out there, but one of them I like best of all is a non-tough guy, a neurosurgeon, Dr. Shukart, who, when the fight started, and somebody calls it a meeting engagement, and then later on it's been, you know, revised, I think, to an ambush, which is probably more accurate. When it started, Shugart's panicking. Hell, he, you know, all this wounded, all this sort of thing around him. He doesn't know how to operate his weapon. He tries to fire it, finally gets it to fire, goes around an anthill, faces two men, Vietnamese type, shoots him on the spot. Later he says to me, don't tell anybody about this, I am a surgeon. And there's so many stories, and you can read them in an excellent book that's been written about it. But I would say that the 2nd, the 7th, no, we will never be known as the Spartans of Thermopylae. That's not what we're about. We're plain men trying to survive. Standing there and trying to do it. Thank God that I came to these two battalions because I learned a lot about Americans. I decided to marry an American, stay here, and proud to be one. The whole thing, I think, when we look at it, is that we can feel so proud about it, and about the men we serve with. I just want to, I didn't talk too much about our fallen over there on there, on the wall. And I've joked a little bit because that's my nature, to try to put the best foot forward to conditions that aren't that excellent. But I want to read something that I scribbled down here. It's a Celtic sort of a thought about the people at the wall. I call it Ia Drang Brothers. At the wall. We walk up to the wall, veterans, crusty and gray. Once we were soldiers and young, brothers forged in battle where the Ia Drang River flows. We stare at your reflection, Bold names reach out to us like dog tags made of granite. First team, 3 East, Ia Drang reunion. The wall speaks back softly. Keep our memories fresh with the tears of loved ones. Bless the Kenneth patriots and heal America's heartland with a kind and gentle rain. God bless you.
That I could tell you about what leadership means, and that's the man that that exemplifies it for me. That horrible Elsie Albany. He was the man that as I was sitting in the bottom of my foxhole waiting in the middle of the night, he walked over standing tall, looked down, and said, "You guys all right?" He was really an inspiration. Listen, I think it's time that we took a break here. Let's all go to the bathroom and do it.